Okay, it is 7 o'clock. It's time to begin our second meeting of this 2016 season. If you have not yet signed in, would you please make your way to the table over there and sign in so we have an accurate roster of who is here tonight. And I'd like to welcome you on behalf of the West, well now let's try this again, White Lake Area Historical Society, otherwise known as WLAHS. Slaughter. Couple of announcements. We are currently without a president and we have our annual meeting in August, so we are welcoming some suggestions for who you would like to see as your president for the next, for sure, 3 years. Dan says 8. Are you volunteering? No. So we have president up. I think my term is finishing as vice president of education, so we need someone to step into that. We also right now have at least 5 different places where some of our equipment and supplies are stored. Bob has a sound system and a coffee maker. We have books, we have banners, we have stuff in our garage. Margo and Bruce have some things in their garage. We need a permanent home for our stuff. So we don't really want to spend a lot of money getting monthly rent if we could avoid it. If you have any ideas where there would be a venue where we have some temperature control, we would really appreciate your input. And humidity control. And yes, like Bruce said, humidity control too, because we have a lot of paper materials. Also, I am holding a book called Fairwind. One of the things that's in our garage is 13 boxes of these, 44 in a box, 572 books. And the Historical Society several years ago published a lot of them. And we are selling them for $5 a piece. I'm halfway through the book. It's written with a different name from the community, but it's basically about White Lake and sailing on White Lake. So if you've got some ideas for book sale venues, we also would like that input. And our next meeting will be July 21, which is the third Thursday in the month. Roger Sharmer. Roger, would you like to come speak to that very quickly?
Okay. I can do it from here.
Okay.
Next meeting basically is Skipper's Landing. Skipper's Landing there's a whole group of people like Jim Logie, myself, George Byam. There's a whole list of people who were like kids. We were like teenagers. And you would go live with Harry and Stella Pillinger, Skipper's Landing, next to the White Lake Yacht Club. We lived in a shack on the hill, and you learned about sailing, refinishing, on and on and on. Anyway, it's sort of a welcome home kind of thing, and different people will talk about different things. And then basically, it's also kind of about Harry and Stella Pillinger. And Harry and Stella basically they started the yachting marina business on White Lake.
And their daughter.
Okay, here's Candy Pillinger, right. Skipper's number one. I'm going to pass this sheet around, or there's a couple sheets. It just talks about the meeting on July 21 at Skipper's Landing. And so, hope to see you all. Bring a chair. It's also down the hill. There's limited driving access. We'll have to figure out some transportation going down. But come on down. It'll be a great meeting.
Park on top and walk down a set of stairs?
Yeah, you can park on top and walk downstairs.
Right.
Yeah.
Thanks, Roger.
7 o'clock.
July 16, the Saturday preceding that, is going to be a different weekend in town for Celebrate White Lake. It traditionally has been the second Saturday of July. This time it is the third Saturday. And Margo is going to talk very briefly about that.
So if you're feeling a little hot, just be glad we don't have rain and 50-mile-an-hour winds, okay? And glad to see you all. I have a sign-up sheet here, and you don't have to become president to sign it. You only have to volunteer 2 hours. We need a couple people Friday the 15th and at the end of the day on the 16th to help move some heavy stuff if you're young and strong. Otherwise, we have some spots to sell things. You sit under a shady pavilion in a chair and you answer questions from people who want a poster or a book or a t-shirt. So it's pretty nice stuff with the public, and it's only 2 hours. So I'm going to send this around with a pen, and I hope it'll come back to me full at the end. Thank you.
Thanks, Margo. And to all of you who have come again, thank you for supporting the Historical Society, and thank you for being willing to wear a name tag so we get to know each other by name. It is my pleasure now to introduce Helen Fink, who is the brains behind this wonderful facility, and she's going to talk for a few minutes and then introduce our speaker. Please help me welcome Helen.
This is very impressive. So many people. Can you all hear now?
Yeah.
Okay. Welcome to the Meinhardy Building. This building was a doctor's office, an apothecary shop at the turn of the century, built in 1903. Dr. John Meinhardy was, and his wife were both German immigrants. They, he had his office and shop in Muskegon at first, and then in 1903 he built this little building right in front of his house on Mears, in what is now the 800 block of Mears. About 5 years ago, we began the process. This wonderful old building was donated to the city of Whitehall. And then a nonprofit was formed. We Can Do This Company, that's our nonprofit. And we raised money, moved the building, and renovated it. It took 5 years to do it, but I think you'll find that it came out beautifully. If you haven't been inside, you haven't looked around, please do so at the end of this meeting. I'll be inside to answer questions if you wish. I'll just tell one quick thing about looking around inside. Instead of putting signs on everything, because everything in this building was either acquired or donated, since it was a vacant building when we got it, instead of putting signs on everything, letting people know who had donated it or where we got it, I assigned everything a number. And there is a packet on the table inside. There are five of them. And you can pick it up. It's called the Meinhardy Collection. And if you look at an object and you say, gee, I wonder where they got that. Now, that's number 27. Let's see. It'll say on the sheet. So that's a way of figuring out what's going on inside if you want. Please look out the back door, because the city of Whitehall opened a vista to the wetland, and they did that this spring, so now we can see the wetland from our back porch, which is also very nice. This project was really grassroots. I was so impressed at how generous and how interested the people of Whitehall and Montague are in preserving an old building like this. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce to you our speaker for tonight, that is Dr. Dan Yakes. He's written a book, and the book is called In Sickness and in Health, A Medical History of Muskegon County. It will soon be from the publishers, right, Dan?
Right.
And I'm going to, I for one will have it on sale in the Meinhardy Building. Where else will it be, Dan?
Well, probably.
Book Nook? Probably at the Book Nook. When I talked to Dan about doing this for us, I thought it would be so appropriate at the Meinhardy Building, as this was a doctor's office, an apothecary shop. And he told me some wonderful stories about things that he discovered in his research about the medical history of this area. And we're dying to hear what he has to say. Please welcome Dr. Dan Yakes.
Good to see all of you here. Before I start, I don't do these books alone. I do the research and the writing, and then someone else does all the graphics and pictures and layout and all that stuff, and that's Dr. Steve Demos, who's over here. Wave his hand, maybe, so I can recognize him. I think this is our fifth collaboration. We did Logging the Fight, and we did the Sylvan Beach book, and a couple of others. He's done other things on his own with other authors, so we'll both go our own ways sometime. Also over there is Dr. Lee Holly. He was one of our informants for this book. This book ends in 1945, and it's hard to find people who remember before 1945. And Lee was in the Navy at the time, but his father was an active physician radiologist here in Muskegon, so he was an invaluable source of information. There are not many like him. All right, we're going to start. This area, I'm only going to be doing basically chapter one of this book. Here's the book. This is the galley proof. In other words, we sent it to the printer. They mock it up. So this is a little thicker than the actual book will be. It's 420 pages, but it'll be on a bit thinner paper. And of course, Steve always says, nobody reads the narrative, they just look at the pictures. So we did a particularly good job on the captions on the pictures. We're going to sell it for $30, which is a real bargain. It has color at both the front and the back, and no color in the middle. We tried to do this like the Wizard of Oz, you know, where you a little black and white, some colored parts. So I'll pass this around if anybody wants to look at it. It should be available on the next talk, which will be in July. We have been assured that. Start over here. It won't be bound like that. It'll have a hardcover, it'll have a Smythsonian, and a lot of good things. That's just a sort of a mock-up. All right, to begin with, this part of Michigan is very hard to research prior to about maybe the 1840s or so. And mainly because most people avoided it. If you take a look at the old charts and records, they'll tell you all about dune land down around Michigan City and Benton Harbor and St. Joe. And then they'll tell you all about Traverse City and Sleeping Bear, that place, and maybe about some islands. Well, they won't tell a thing about what's in between. So I'm taking some assumptions. I'm assuming we're a little bit like the area to the south and a little bit like the area to the north. But we really don't know. Even Schoolcraft, Henry Schoolcraft, traveled through here in 1820. He was originally with Governor Cass, Lewis Cass. But he says practically nothing. He mentions Muskegon. He mentions White River. Well, he doesn't say anything about them. So even he ignored it. Why did they ignore it? Well, there's no decent harbor. In a small vessel, you might be able to get into these small little entry areas, but not a big boat. So they simply have no way of spending the night or getting succor from the lake. And of course, the lake acts up every now and again. So that's part of it. And then once you got inland, all the lakes were surrounded by swamps, and swamps had mosquitoes and all kinds of other bad things, and so you couldn't get very far. And nobody really knew much about the trails. And even the Indians avoided the place, so there were no permanent settlers among the Indians in this area. Closest we have were some settlements up in Oceana County. And then at Grand Rapids, of course, that would be the other. I'm only going to talk about the White Lake area tonight, but it covers the whole county, and it does have a definite thesis. Now, this was started 5 years ago, before our current issues with government regulations and Flint water problems, but that's all part of the picture. You can't have a safe, healthy community if you don't have safe water supply, if you don't have relatively poor air, if you don't have laws that protect the food we eat. And so that's all part and parcel of this. The basic thesis is we would not be where we are today if it were not for the medical community, the doctors, the dentists, the nurses, the apothecaries, and their supporters who promoted those kinds of things at a time when this place was governed by lumbermen and other people who were polluting the environment. And of course they did. They destroyed the environment, and then most of them moved away. So that left only a few. Those that stayed helped with the redemption, like Charles Hackley, for example, and others. But so many of them were not even residents of the area to begin with. And so, beginning in the 1880s, a group of doctors and druggists in Muskegon started calling these issues into question, and they are the ones eventually responsible for building a wastewater plant and for providing filtration of the water coming out of Lake Michigan, and for building the hospitals in Muskegon and all these other things that we enjoy today but might not have had had it not been for these people. Muskegon doesn't get a hospital until 1903. Every other city in Muskegon had a hospital by that time. Even little places like Big Rapids, and almost every place, even little tiny places had hospitals. We had none. Closest would have been Grand Rapids. So it wasn't a very healthy place to live, except for those people who did the work. Now for our area, what I wanted to do today is to talk a little bit about some of the early physicians who visited this area. And to do that, I need to look at my notes again. When it all began, Muskegon didn't even exist as a county. As you probably know, Muskegon was a creation of the state legislature in 1859. And most of the people living in the northern part had no part of it. They wanted to become a separate county. And in fact, the citizens of White River destroyed all their township records rather than turn them over to these ne'er-do-wells who were taking control of the county. That's well known. Northern part of the county was part of Oceana County at some time and part of Ottawa County at other times, and the southern part was always part of Ottawa County. So if you're looking for material, don't bother looking for Muskegon. You need to look for Ottawa County. One of the sources we used, actually I utilized about 30 years ago, they're the R.G. Dunn records that are housed at the Baker Library at Harvard University. Now, I have an example of that. I brought some with me. You're not supposed to copy the copies. You have to send the copies back to the original. They only allowed me 30 copies for my whole week there. But they look something like this. That's a third of a page that I'm holding up there. These are big folios. They run about 1,000 pages each, and there are two volumes. So I went through the best I could in 2 weeks, and I found this information. R.G. Dunn was a credit reporting company. Well, it still is to some extent. They had agents all over the United States and Canada, and their business was keeping up on people who might be buying things that would be shipped to them from elsewhere. So they wanted to know the trustworthiness of the customer. So if you bought something, chances are some anonymous local agent would be contacted and they'd ask about you. And this person was, they usually had several in a town like Muskegon, two or three in a town like Whitehall or Montague, and they would give you an honest appraisal of that person's credit worthiness. Now some of you may have heard of Ruth Hobler. She was one of the earliest settlers around here, came in 1850 at the mouth. We have an excerpt from her diary. Let me tell you what they wrote about Ruth. This is from July of 1871. She can pay, but don't. Make no habit of it. She and her husband managed to evade the payment of his debts. In other words, she would pay her debts, but they had trouble collecting from her husband. June of 1871, deal cautiously. Personally responsible, but not dependable. Will pay if there is no chance to evade it. Now, 5 years later, the commendations were a little bit more honest, were treated her more favorably. This is 76. Is good for any bill she may contract. But then, a year later, it says, is responsible if not strictly honest. So, again, we don't know for sure if this correspondent was fair or not, but what they do is they give you an insight into persons, their character, and you can either pay attention to it or not. And of course, we know how that comes out as we make political decisions too, of course, whether you want to listen to somebody or not listen to them. It all depends much on the whoever wrote down the comment. Now, some of these are early doctors. Of course, we had no local doctors who lived in this area until about 1848. That's our earliest one. And prior to that, we had nothing but itinerants or someone who came in for a special case. The first one I came across that not strictly a doctor, but a person who had an ailment and could not be treated. The name was Jacques Dufresne. That name may not be familiar to you. Perhaps you have heard the name Gordon Hubbard. He was a fur trapper, fur trader, making his rookie venture into the trade in 1820. He came from Chicago originally, but traveled up to Mackinac Island, which was the center for the American Fur Company, and then was placed on a crew that was going to trade for furs in the West Michigan area. And so he came down here by canoe, and the leader of the expedition was Jacques Dufresne. Experienced woodsman, had been around for a long time. Well, they didn't trust Gordon because he had never been in the woods before, so they left him at a cabin on Muskegon Lake, on the north side near Bear Lake Channel, and there he spent the winter all by himself. Barely survived, caught fish in the lake, and would occasionally find a dead skunk or some other animal to eat, and barely made it through. And then in the spring, Jacques and the rest of the company returned after having been trading for furs up the Muskegon River. And they got into some trouble then. Jacques suffered from swollen legs, swollen ankles. He had infected, and so they decided to return to Mackinac Island. And on the way back, Jacques died. And he died just off the coast of White Lake. So they buried him in the sand dunes at what would now be Lloyd's Landing. And it is said that the Indians, it had been an important stop for the Indians in the past, but they quit going there because they said at night they would hear someone in French calling out the names of the cards he was dealing. And probably still haunted. So be careful if you put in there at night. It may still be around, for all I know. Now, the second time we had an event, medical event, that was recorded was in 1839. In that year, the brig, the Neptune, foundered off the coast of Silver Lake. That'd be the little Sauble Point. It was a brig, so they had 11 passengers and they had 9 crewmen, but only 3 people survived, all of them crewmen. The captain, supposed to go down with the ship, and his mate and one of the crewmen, none of the passengers survived. They landed at the off the coast, right at Little Sauble Point, and they made their way southward and finally encountered an Indian village. This is a composite map drawn from the survey maps of the 1830s. This is a modern map, but the authors took all of the survey maps from the 1830s and pieced them all together and included all of the settlements and Indian trails and so forth. We don't know how the crew survived, other than that they sent an Indian to Grand Rapids to get the closest doctor, who was Charles Shepherd. He was the second resident doctor in Grand Rapids, stayed there for the rest of his life, 50 years or more. He came to the site, and the question is, of course, how did he come? So we put this map in the book, and we postulated the route he took. So let me show you. This is Grand Rapids, and you can see there are Indian trails emanating north, south, east, west of it, even in 1837. There's a trail that comes up this way, and it's labeled Muskegon Trail. So we know they must have traveled that way. And then, when they got about up here, they started here, and they took the Muskegon Trail up here. Then it peters out when they got to Moreland Township. This would be Moreland today. And then I think they took this route south of Moreland and picked up another trail that took them over to Wolf Lake. There's an old Indian settlement we know about there. And then they probably traveled along, there's an escarpment there above the river. And they probably traveled along there. And Muskegon had settlement by that time, so they probably got a ferry or a boat there and were able to then get up to White Lake. The captain had gotten down to White Lake. The two crewmen had stayed at the Indian settlements. They're on the other side here. Here's Sable Point, and the Indian settlements are right down in here. So that's the area we're looking at. And all three men survived. I'm going to start over here. He had to amputate four limbs, all legs, in the process. But again, this shows you, what do you do when you come down with an ailment like Jacques Dufresne or these crewmen, and there's no doctor around? Yes, the Indians had some solutions for some ailments, but they're not able to amputate limbs. They don't know surgery. So you're really probably going to die if you don't have a doctor. Now the next installment we have is really the first doctor in Muskegon County. Now if you read the material that is produced in Muskegon, they will tell you it was Dr. McSherry, who came in 1849 and lived his whole life there and died at the local clinic in Muskegon in 1898. He was recluse. He only treated people if he wanted to. He was a little bit nuts, most people think. But he came from Muskegon, so he must be all right. Well, there were two doctors in Muskegon County before Dr. McSherry arrived. And, of course, one of them was here in White Lake. Thomas Phillips came here in 1848 and settled first at the Dalton Mills, which was up the White River, and then later on at the mouth. We have a story about him. 1848, he was trying to make a living, and he got a call from John Hansen. Now, behind you is Hansen Street, the same Hansen. He was one of our first settlers. He was living at that time in the Mears boarding house, which is still there, although it's been modified at the mill pond. And he was sort of running the mill. He was a ship's captain. He carried a Mears of lumber here and there, and freight and so forth. But he was in charge of the mill. A man had come there, stumbled in, had smallpox. So they called Dr. Phillips. Now smallpox, of course, was a very virulent disease. You normally died from it, and this man did. But no one else in the house, and there were 20 other people living there, mostly men, but some women and children, they all survived. That's quite a credit to a physician that granted the initial person died, but they did not spread the disease to anyone else. Again, it's an important element of all medicine. So there's Dr. Phillips. Now, 2 years later, he moved up to Oceana County, and he spent the rest of his life in Claybanks, That's the township just north of us here in Oceana. Another one that we should mention is Mary Ann Bennett. She is the wife of Abner Bennett. He was a lay preacher for the Methodist Church. They came to this area in 1850, settled at the mouth. She would be what we would call at that time a granny woman. In other words, someone who would take care of people's ailments within reason. She had some medical knowledge, but mostly she was a midwife. And a lot of children were brought into this world. She lived here the rest of her life, except for a brief time in Muskegon, and brought many, many children into the world. In 1883, the state of Michigan passed a law requiring all people practicing medicine to register with the county clerk and the state of Michigan. If they did not, they could not practice any longer. Now, you did not have to have a medical degree. You did not have to have any evidence of having attended school. All you had to do was say your name, how many years you had been practicing medicine. You had to practice at least for 5 years under the law, and what your school was, School of Medicine. Schools of medicine, what we don't think about them any longer, they're all pretty much the same. We think about osteopaths, perhaps, and regular doctors. But back in the 1850s, 60s, 70s, there were many, many different schools of medicine. And we had what were called regular doctors. Those are men and later on women who claimed not to belong to any particular sect of medicine. In other words, they believed that any type of cure could work as long as they had some knowledge of it or background in it. They were not stuck into any particular line of work. But a lot of people didn't like regulars because they were often very brusque. They didn't learn a bedside manner. They used crude techniques such as, some of them, again, not all, bloodletting and leeches, and they prescribed calomel and blue mass and stuff that contained arsenic and all kinds of bad things. So some of them were not very well regarded. But of course, that's the one that prevailed, and mainly because they borrowed from these other schools things that worked. The second school was called homeopathy. We have homeopaths today. Homeo means opposite of whatever it is. So they believed that, got it wrong. I'm thinking of the next school. That's allopaths. That's the same as. Homeopaths believe it is that they needed to give you something that that represented the same symptoms as whatever was ailing. And if you would take that, that would cure you of whatever the bigger issue was. So they'd give you some microscopic amount, say 1 out of 100,000 parts of whatever this chemical was, and that presumably gave you immunity. Now there is some truth to this. We give people shots today that give them some immunity to whatever the virus might be. But, of course, it doesn't work all the time. It works some of the time. Allopaths were just the opposite of that. They often were regular doctors. Then you have what are called hydropaths. We have several springs around here. And Spring Lake, Fruitport, Muskegon, White Lake all had springs that presumably had curative powers. Mainly they contained minerals that were sometimes smelly and offensive. We still have some of that water coming through our well, and it's got rust in it. And if you either drank it, rubbed it on your body, smelled it, made it into steam, and you breathed it, then it would cure you. Now, what they did, of course, was establish a spa, a hotel around the mineral spring, and they would, usually these were wealthy people, who had money and could afford to take a few weeks off. And they would go to the spa and drink the water or bathe in it or immerse themselves. And they'd come back here. Now, of course, I don't know that it was the water. It may have been simply they were drug addicts or drunkards or whatever. And the hospital or the spa would not allow them to drink or take drugs while they were there. So they may have been cured because of some other cause than that one. We had a few doctors around here who were botanicals. Thank you for not walking on the weeds here. These are probably important botanicals that could cure you of this or that. And I make fun of it, but many of them worked. You know, the bark of certain trees will be curative. Certain weeds or pods or nuts can have curative powers. And for the most part, the medical community has adopted those that worked and pretty much discarded those that didn't. But there were doctors around. No school taught that. You learned that from Indians, or you learned it from Grandma Gehizabob from Croatia, back home, or wherever it was. And they usually did work in certain cases, see? So they're not going to last for long if they don't have some curative powers. Let me jump a little bit. You perhaps have heard of John Wheeler. John Wheeler was a doctor, but also a druggist. Came here in 1863, settled at the Mouth, and then when the Mouth settlement pretty much gave up, they logged off pretty much all the trees, they moved up to either Whitehall or Montague, or they left entirely. And Wheeler came to Whitehall and built a drug store in a barn, basically. He got use of part of a barn and peddled his drugs out of that. Doctors were able to prescribe drugs and compound their own drugs until relatively recently. I suppose they still could. It just isn't worth their trouble to do that. It's easier to buy it from a manufacturer. But doctors like Dr. Meinhardy, too, probably compounded many of his own drugs and sold them to his customers. I passed out a little sheet, fees of different kinds of medicines, fees for different kinds of hospital visits. And you'll notice that to write a prescription costs you money, either from 50 cents to $2. Now, doctors today don't charge you fees for prescriptions. Maybe they do and they fit it into the bigger bill. But back then, they would have preferred to make up their own drugs and not send you to a druggist. First of all, you couldn't always trust druggists. Until the Pure Food and Drug Act passed in 1906, you couldn't guarantee that the drugs would be strength that you wanted it. You couldn't guarantee that the ingredients were pure. You couldn't guarantee anything. So they preferred to do it themselves. They got a little of the profit that way, but they also ensured that the ingredients were useful. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. I'm not getting the normal sound. So most doctors, up until about the 40s, prescribed their own drugs. They made their own drugs themselves. Unless it was something unusual, they'd send you to the prescription desk. So Dr. Wheeler came here. I don't know where his barn was, but it had to be around here somewhere, because there wasn't much to Whitehall back in 1863. He remained here until 1881. Again, being a doctor was not highly profitable. You take a look at those fees, and they're not very high, and they around here would have been at the lower end of those ranges that are given there. Those ranges are for doctors all over the state of Michigan, and doctors tended to charge their patients what they thought their patient could afford. So if they had a poor patient, they might treat him for nothing. If they had a well-to-do patient, they would charge him at the high end. And then, of course, when the wealthy patient didn't pay him, he'd go on their deadbeat list, and which he would share them with all the other doctors, not to treat this guy until he started paying his bills. But much different than today, where your bills are going to basically be the same regardless of your income to the doctor. So that's why you have the ranges there. And this part of the state, of course, would have been at the lower end because we were not a high-priced area compared to, say, Detroit and Grand Rapids. The next doctor I'd like to bring to your attention, Dr. George Carr, maybe never heard of him. He's a Civil War vet in his favor. Many doctors were, did serve in the Civil War, if they were of a proper age to do so. He came here to White Lake in the late 1870s and set up a practice, but apparently he wasn't particularly good at doctoring, but he was good at wooing the ladies. In 1883, he ran off with the wife of George Carlisle, one of our local lumbermen, and we never heard from him again, so we don't know about him too much. I think I told this story before, Adolf Anderson. Adolf was from Montague, a true example of a young man who pulled himself up by the bootstraps. Again, he had nothing. His father died when he was young. His mother took in sewing. They lived in a house right across from the old Dowling building over in Montague. It's sort of on a hill. The Heaton family lives there now. And she would take in laundry and do sewing for the ladies of the town, and that was their only income. Before Adolf was born, though, his father worked as a cook in the lumber camps around here, and he tells the story back in 1881-82, the winter of that year, his father and mother and older brother, he hadn't been born yet, were at a camp just to east of New Era, up in Oceana County, probably Staples and Coville place. And his brother, who was like a year old, got a carbuncle on his neck, and it was very painful, and of course just a baby didn't know what was going on, crying all kinds of things. So his father asked the men in the camp, would you hike down to Montague to get a doctor, 16 miles. They would go east to hit the railroad and then take the railroad track south. It was a blizzard, middle of the winter. Nobody would do it. So he said, he was the camp cook. So he said, well, I'll do it, but there ain't gonna be no breakfast tomorrow because there's nobody here to cook it. And so they were kind of disgruntled about that. But he took off and walked the whole way down to Montague and got the doctor. Dr. Ellie Jones was in this area for many years in Montague. And the doctor put him in his cutter. All doctors had cutters for the winter work. And they took their horse and cutter up to follow the railroad tracks and then New Era, they cut east. And they got to the top of a hill. There was a little stream that flowed down there between these two little hills, and they were at the top of the hill, started down. And as they were starting down, they saw a logging sledge on the other side, and it was loaded full of logs. And those are heavy, as you may know. And so the man driving the horses decided this would be my chance to get back at this guy because didn't have breakfast, kind of disgruntled. So he started his horses going lickety-split down this hill, and they went right past Anderson's rig, and they barely escaped death. I mean, they had to drive into a ravine in order to prevent being hit. The man was fired, but of course, that did them little good. It really shook them up. So the doctor stayed there, not only treated young Jim, but everybody else in camp who had ailments for the next week. I mean, the snow was really heavy anyway, so it was hard for him to get back. So we have lots of stories of that sort that that we can tell. I've sort of decided to end my stories about doctors here. Of course, I have a list of at least 24 doctors in this area. Some of them stayed a long time, some of them only stayed a short period, depended on how good the business was and whether they were attracted. And that's just through the end of the 19th century. And of course, we've had many, many more since that time. So it's really kind of a big chore to try to track them all down, and I have not been able to do so. Some of them, of course, were doctors, some of them medical doctors, some of them were also druggists. And there are stories about every one of them, except that I don't know them. Let me deal, though, with another one who turned out to be a druggist as well, Dr. Zerum, I have to turn my page, Meisner. Meisner came here again during the Civil War in the 1860s, settled at the mouth, and then moved up to Montague and Whitehall again. It's very common for that. And he went into partnership with a man named Levi Shackleton. Shackleton had been a druggist, among other things. He had a kind of, druggists came from all kinds of backgrounds. Some of them had been tavern keepers or hotel keepers, carpenters, all kinds of other things. So it gives you some impression about the kinds of background you needed to be a druggist, which is to say none. All you had to do was how to sell stuff. And the devil take the hindmost in terms of whether they were any good for you or not. There were educated druggists, and they stood out, but not all of them were that way. So Shackleton had kind of a varied past, but he had served as an apprentice druggist in Muskegon, and now was in White Lake, Whitehall. He partnered up with Meisner. Meisner himself is an interesting character. No evidence he ever went to medical school, but he did work for Charles Mears at one time, so that's his background. Charles Mears had two mills around here, the one at the Mill Pond and the other at Duck Lake. And Meisner worked for him at Duck Lake for a couple of years, probably as a mill hand, but also as a lumberjack, because they logged off that area at about that time. And then he went down south to Plainwell and Kalamazoo, and apparently became kind of an itinerant doctor. He probably worked with some physician at that time. That was how most doctors became doctors. They worked for two or three or four years. They read the books. They helped the doctor with his cases. They learned from him. And if he was a good doctor, called a preceptor in those days, then he turned out to be a good doctor too. And if he was a quack, he learned how to be a quack. So it all depended on who was your teacher. Meisner seems to have been a pretty good doctor. He set up a business with Shackleton, and they were in business for quite a while. They again took over a building owned by someone else and rented for quite a while. Eventually Shackleton left and Meisner remained as both a doctor and a druggist. You perhaps have heard of the name Wheeler, John Wheeler, another early doctor, also had a drugstore. His store was up on top of the hill there, right near Colby Street. I don't know exactly where the building was. It burned down eventually, but he was another of our locals. You know the Ruggles name, I'm sure. That's a relatively modern name. One of the Ruggles ran a realty establishment. I remember going to an estate sale or auction, it was, of Eli Ruggles' estate. He was a Civil War vet and had kept all of his Civil War regalia, passed on to the family, and I was able to buy some Civil War era medals from that collection. So it's always, if you're planning on passing away, I hope you pass your stuff on to your descendants, or give it to a museum, archive, or something like that, because that's how we historians get our information. If we didn't have those archives and those possessions that are passed along, we wouldn't be able to do our work, and that's a vital point. I plan to pass mine on. So Ruggles had this pharmacy. We have a picture of it. It was located right on the edge of the little hill over here, about where that new Century building is today, but kind of hanging over, right over the railroad tracks. It was basically a barn originally. It had stores and offices in the upper stories, but the drugstore was in the basement. And it looks kind of crude, but you do what you have to do in order to stay in business. Again, we have the Meinhardi store. Now, I had not heard that John Meinhardi worked in Muskegon. I have him in Milwaukee, and then he came to Montague in 1881, and he had his office in the Ripley Building. The Ripley Building is in Montague. It's Lipka's drugstore, and they would rent out the upper floor to doctors and dentists, and the Farmers State Bank, which is kitty corner from it, was used by the Fine Arts Council. That also had doctors' offices in the second story. Doctors in those days either operated out of their homes, or they operated out of some downtown location, centrally located, like a drugstore or a bank. Those would be common places. So I have Meinhardi there along with several other doctors. And then he moved over to Whitehall, but in between he may very well have lived in Muskegon. I lost track of him along in the 1880s. He did not have an actual separate office in Whitehall. He operated out of his own home, and he had a drugstore next to it. Now, as I understand it, and I could very well be wrong, that building burned down, the first drugstore, and I think this is the second drugstore that he built, and it was, I think, in front of his house rather than beside it. I don't know how he operated. Those records are no longer with us. I do know he had two sons, and I knew one of those sons. I sang in the choir with him. His name was also John Meinhardi, and another son was a dentist. Probably he compounded some of his own drugs, but I'm suspecting that he bought a bunch of them from other places. There were at least two druggists in Muskegon that did a retail but also a wholesale business. Bennett Drugs, and that's the successor to the Jessup Drug Company that eventually became Kuhn and Hops. It was the biggest drugstore in Muskegon, but they had a tremendous clientele all over the country. They would make things up and sell them to these other retailers. So I donated a bunch of those bottles to the museum under the assumption that he might, Dr. Meinhardi here, may have sold them here, being as close as he was to Muskegon. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. I don't know otherwise, but they are legitimate bottles. They are legitimate. A lot of the drugstores would produce their own bottles. They'd either put labels on them, or they had these bottles made up especially with their name engraved, embossed on the actual glass. So we have quite a few of those around, too, from local drug companies. Never found one for Meinhardi. If it existed, Norm Allman would have had one. And I didn't see one when I was there, so I don't know that for sure. Norm just had an estate sale a few days ago. Probably the drugstores you know the best are Ripley's Drugstore, which is the original of Lipka's. And it's the building's still there. They no longer sell drugs. And that was owned and built by Lafayette Ripley. Built the whole building and then, of course, rented out. I mean, that's the way to do it. If the drug business isn't too bad, at least you can have customers who are renting your space and make a living that way. And then, of course, that passed on to his son, Montague Whitehall Ripley. That's what they did in those days. They had fun with names. He was born in Whitehall. A lot of his business was in Montague. So he names his son Montague Whitehall Ripley. Better than the guy who ran the Goodrich Steamship Company in Muskegon had five children. His last name was Leak. So guess what he named his five kids? Michigan, Huron, Erie. Yeah. I'd like to have a father like that. Erie's not so bad. Now, here in Whitehall, of course, you probably know the name Pitkin. Becky Pitkin, Becky Norton, now, and her husband. Now, I think they're still running it, although the daughters may be running their drugstore now. But that's the Pitkin drugstore. Clarence Pitkin came here in the 1890s, late 1880s, early 90s, and started working for Ripley, and then he went off on his own and built his own building. Worked for Ruggles, too, for a while. He was our, as far as I know, the first actually educated druggist in this area. In other words, he had been to the, he'd been to college, he knew something about, now I don't think he ever actually got a degree. Now his son did, Clarence E., got a college degree. But he, Clarence G., the original one, did pass the state law, the state mandated test for apothecary management for druggists. Now that was another state law in 1885 when that passed. It did not require you to have a college degree, but it did require you to pass this test. And he passed it, as did another local, not really Montague local, but several Muskegon doctors also passed it as they were preparing to become doctors. So that's really quite an accomplishment. Now I mentioned there are three state laws all that came at about the same time, and that fits into my overall thesis that you needed some government regulation in order to make things work properly. I mean, today, how would you like to go to a doctor who only needed to call himself a doctor in order to saw off your leg? That's what you would have had back in the 19th century until the law passed. So you have the Physicians Registration Act of 83, you have the Dentists Registration Act of 83, and you have the Pharmacists Registration Act of 85. And they all really put some teeth into the preparation for all of these different medical fields. And again, they were all pretty much controlled by the medical establishment in Michigan, but for myself, I'm glad that they did. I certainly don't care to go to a doctor who never went to college or never had any proper training. I mean, come on. And by the way, I did hand out a list of fees. Those fees, of course, no longer apply, except Steve says he will perform all those procedures for the price listed. The top end. Of course, he hasn't practiced for a while. He's retired now, see, so. But today, of course, it's kind of amusing to take a look at what people did 100 and some years ago for procedures that are still done today. I think I have ignored the dentists, and when I get through with them, I think I will take questions if there's still time. We do have some local dentists who came here back in the 19th century. Dentistry was probably the hardest of all of these fields to fill properly. Usually dentists were itinerants. That is to say, there wasn't enough business in a small town like this to set up shop at all. You wouldn't have enough business. And again, it's one of those things, when do you go to the dentist? You would not have gone for an annual checkup. You would have gone only when the pain was so great that you could not tolerate it any longer and none of the home remedies worked. You would try to pull a tooth yourself or have somebody else pull it for you or find some other solution. And then, and only then, would you go to the dentist. And of course, the dentist often used crude techniques also, so you might want to avoid him even then. So many of our early doctors didn't have very much education, formal education, although the University of Michigan Dental School is the third created in the whole nation. They established that school back in the 1850s as part of the homeopathic college there. So. And the University of Michigan was one of only three universities in the state of Michigan, in the whole United States, whose degrees were honored in Europe, where most of the good medical and dental schools were located at that time. So the state is making progress, more than other states, but still, most dentists didn't avail themselves of a degree. Probably at least the dentist I have found, was the first was B.F., probably Benjamin F. Treat. These doctors and dentists were ashamed of their names, I think. They never give you their real names, they give you their initials. So I spent hours trying to find out the real names of these men and women. And sometimes I didn't find it in his case. He was a Civil War veteran again, had served as a dentist in the Union Army, second lieutenant, and when the war ended, he came here to Michigan and settled in Whitehall and opened a practice. Now, he found he could not make a living being a dentist in Whitehall in 1867, so he rented a saloon and hotel, another word for brothel, here in Whitehall. Our red light district was over where Goodridge Park is today, if you were interested in availing yourselves of that place. And so that's where he set up, but he couldn't make a living there either. So he had to go back into dentistry. He was estranged from his wife. He lived in one place, she lived in another. When he left town, she did not go with him. That I know. Again, he was mentioned by the Dunn and R.G. Dunn reporters. He's, it says, let's see, estranged from wife, fair dentist, low character, which is, tells a lot. He is our first dentist. We've had several others since then. Again, they're all recorded. If you have the time or the inclination to look up any of them, the dental records and the medical records and the pharmaceutical records are all over in Lansing at the Archives of Michigan. Mostly the people who go there today are genealogists, but there are historians, and they really, the people who work there really know their business, and they can get you whatever it is, as long as they have it in their collection. So Muskegon County sent all of its records over there back in the 70s. And it's a huge trove of stuff. We're very lucky. Most counties didn't send their stuff over there, but Muskegon did. So if you want to know about not only medicine, but dentistry, they have the entire county jail log. If you have an ancient relative who might have gotten in trouble with the law, probably in there. They not only have his name, they have his eye color, height, weight, religion, if he had any. It's really a wonderful source. It isn't organized very well, but you know, if you got the time, it's really a valuable resource. Now I'm open for any questions. I don't know how much longer you want to take there, kiddo.
Well, let's see if there are any questions.
I've got a question because somehow I missed. You said the county jail log is where?
It's at the Archives of Michigan. It's a large building. It houses the State Museum and the Library of Michigan, and the Archives of Michigan. They used to be called differently. They used to call it the Michigan State Library, but the people at Michigan State University kept wondering, why are we getting all these people looking for the State Library? And there's an archive there too, so they changed their name to the Library of Michigan and the Archives of Michigan. Yes.
Similar to some of your comments about getting into the professions, I did some research about a fellow in Big Rapids named Rose, who was successful enough to add an addition to the city. You know, he owned the land and annexed it to the city, but he published in a vanity book, which was common at the time, where you write your own biography and lots of people, you know, you're paid for space. And in that vanity book, what he said is that I started out to be a portrait painter, but I found that my vision was so compromised that I took up dentistry instead. And he's saying that proudly.
Sure.
It's a vanity published book that's going to go all over the county.
You know, I've known a lot of dentists, and they usually have a hobby other than dentistry. And I think if I were a dentist, I'd have a hobby too. And it always has something that's creative, like small carvings or well, kinds of unusual habits that I suppose keep their mind going and they're creative. And I would think it'd be kind of tiresome looking down at the mouth for 50. And our area dentists, I looked them up. We have, when you become a dentist, you're probably going to be in that field for 60 years. They just don't retire. And they typically pass it on to a son or daughter. Doctors do that to some extent, and druggists as well, but not like the dentists. I think about half of the dentists were multi-generation dentists in this area. And again, partly that's because of the expense of setting up an office, you know, and establishing a clientele. If it's father, son, grandson, or granddaughter, then you're passing the clientele as well to your own family. And it saves the younger one the expense of setting up shop. It's really curious about all of those different fields. Are there others over here? Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry. Sir.
Did the lumber barons like Hackley and Hume and Barry, those guys, did they have company doctors?
Did they have
company doctors?
Oh, well, that's a big argument. I have not found anything about the lumberman, it was a common practice in some lumber camps and some sawmills and logging camps and mining camps. They were quite big, like Calumet and Hecla in the UP had doctors, staff doctors. But around here, that was not considered kosher. The medical society had big, long arguments about whether that was ethical or not. That argument doesn't begin until the 20th century. So if there were such men or women in the 19th century, I haven't come across them. Now, there was one possible example. You mentioned Ferry. Ferry didn't live around. None of the Ferries lived here. But they were in partnership with the Dowling family. The Dowlings owned one quarter of the mill, and the Ferries owned the other three quarters. And one of the Dowling daughters, Grace Dowling, became a doctor. And she probably did work for the firm. But that wasn't until the 1890s. And then she died very shortly after the turn of the century. That's as close as I've come to a company doctor around here. But why do the other doctors resent it? Well, they basically thought this was stealing business from them. They're very good at supporting projects that are benefit to the overall community, as long as that did not interfere with their own livelihood. And they regarded companies that hired their own doctors as unethical, because they claim that this prohibited the patient from choosing his own doctor, and they felt that the doctor should and patient should have a relationship with one another. Having a doctor versus having no doctor at all seems to me better for the patient, because the patient wouldn't have been able to afford a doctor of his own, in all likelihood. The other rationale they had was that they did not like establishing preset rates for care. In other words, if you were a company doctor, you worked for the company regardless of what patients might come before you. If you had a spate of sawmill injuries, that's one thing. Maybe you'd go another month and have nothing but a sore thumb here or there. And they thought that the fee should be negotiated between the patient and the doctor, and not have a company intervene. That little section I call Don't Mess with Mr. In-Between. They didn't like insurance companies, they didn't like other companies, didn't like unions that interfered in the patient-physician relationship. But for me, I think that the company doctor probably was a benefit, as was the union doctor if they had one of those. Eventually, the physicians came around, we had quite a few in Muskegon County who were company doctors, but at the big plants like Continental and Brunswick, and the large Gerber had one in Fremont. Smaller companies couldn't probably afford it. Other questions?
Any comment on Dr. John Alexander Dolly?
Well,
the faith healer.
Well, yeah. He did not register. So,
could you repeat the question?
The question, what about Dr. Dowie? I think it was a self-imposed doctorate. He was more of a religious leader than a physician. But Roger is right. He did claim to be a faith healer. But I'm not aware that he had any particular credentials in that field. There are two physician registration acts. The second one came in 1899, and Dowie would have been around here at that time. And he did not register, I can tell you that. So if he did cure anyone, he was in violation of the law. But as the law was written, someone had to complain. And perhaps his clientele would not complain. I have been commissioned to write another book on the White Lake area that is supposed to be out next summer if I get it done, and Steve and I get it done. So we'll put that in there, all right?
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Given the great variation amount of training that these early physicians had, when did malpractice come into play? Certainly there was a lot of malpractice committed in those days.
Well, his question is, when did malpractice come into play? I have not come across it. I suspect that does not come into play until insurance laws went into effect. I mean, you had the same kind of problems with injuries on the job. And let's say you were injured working at the sawmill or a factory or something. You could sue the company, but chances of winning were extremely small. The company would have hired an attorney. You probably wouldn't have been able to afford it, or maybe your family members couldn't afford it because you died. So what most men who had any income at all would do would be to get out an insurance policy for themselves, a life insurance policy. So, and sometimes they did have accidental and dismemberment clauses. So that's about all you can do. So they would usually, many of them were immigrants. And we forget about so many of our early residents of this area were immigrants. They often had no money if they were laid off. They had no family. But if they had any income, they would buy some insurance, and then they might get $1,000 or a $2,000 settlement when they died. And that would be about all they could expect. I'd have to look it up to find out when malpractice came in, but I'll bet it was in the 30s. A lot of, I would call it progressive legislation. Others might not agree, but that kind of stuff would have come along in the 30s. We can look it up, and I will. Yeah. Was there a question for Bruce?
Yeah, I'm thinking of the Woodsman.
Yes.
I think they called it the International Order of Woodsmen, kind of a mutual benefit society.
Yes.
Insurance-ish.
Yes.
Did that exist around here?
Yeah, we did have an order. I don't know about Whitehall, but Muskegon had such an entity. And of course, the Knights of Labor is another one that provided insurance. Probably the best example is the Ladies of the Maccabees, the LOTM. It was founded in Muskegon in the 1880s. They sold what they called insurance. You could buy it for your whole family, usually 10 to 20 cents per family member per month. And then if anybody in the family who was covered took ill, they would pay for your hospital and doctor bill, regardless of how big it was. Now, of course, at those rates, they didn't last very long. They'd sell it door to door, and we didn't have a real hospital either locally, so about all you could hope for was some kind of minimal care until the 1900s. They eventually dropped that, and it was taken up by a derivative company. Their headquarters was in Port Huron. The name of that? Women's Benefit Association. My mother was a member. I remember going, this was in Port Huron. They had insurance. They also had a credit union. Back in the 40s, 1940s, women were not allowed to have bank accounts. So they weren't allowed to take out insurance on their own. So my mother was a very feisty, assertive type. And the bank would not let her have a bank account. So she had a bank account with me. I was 6 years old, but I had the right gender. So we were co-members on an account, and I didn't even know it existed. But so they also provided insurance, both medical and health insurance. Again, people didn't trust insurance people. I don't know why not, but they would go with their own kind. If you were a woman, you'd go with a company that was run by women. If you were Polish, you'd go with a Polish company, or Italian, Italian, and so forth. They just don't trust the natives. I don't blame them, you know, because they're going to look for a payout after you die. What are you going to do? And you want someone you can trust, and so that's very common. Yeah, other questions? Sorry to take up all your time. Well, we hope this book will be published in 3 weeks. That is, it's been printed, but it hasn't been bound. So that is what we're waiting for. And we hope to have some copies when we have that next lecture in 3 weeks or so.
Thank you very much. So, refreshments, please come through the Meinhardy building if you wish. The caboose is open as well. If you haven't been in there, you might want to take a look. And thank you so very much, Dan. Wonderful. Thank you.